thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me to the organisers. I apologise, you've heard me coughing. I had rather a bad chest infection and pneumonia a week ago, so I did lose a bit of time. But I've been given an impossible task to talk about Down syndrome, osteogenesis imperfecta and connective tissue disorders in 15 minutes. But I'm going to try. It's going to be a little touch upon it, and I know that the plan is perhaps to put together some of these presentations and put them forward into a small publication. I'll be able to expand a little bit if I'm allowed to for that publication, and you'll have more information. But I called it, I want to sort of try and bring things together and summarise a little bit and sort of tell you why I think it's relevant, because we're talking about the genetics, and I've heard talks already about how we need to define the phenotype, and because it's such a widespread multisystem disorder, it's quite obvious there is, it's particularly for the hypermobile EDS, it's not going to be just a single gene. It's going to be what we truly see as polygenic, a number of genes. And if we're to try and identify what those genes are, we are going to have to be very, very critical and clear about defining the phenotype, which means the clinical presentation and the clinical features. And then we can then join that together with the genotype, the particular findings we have. I call it the modern Hydra because is it in that mythical creature, the multi-headed serpent, the Hydra, which Hercules slayed. If you cut off the head, two cream up. And I think that's what EDS is. And I'm sure Professor Graham, I missed your talk, I apologize, would tell you that we've evolved in this condition. And over the decades, more and more aspects of the condition have come about, and this understanding about Chiari and atlantoaxial instability is becoming the thing for this decade, and we will begin to understand more and more aspects of the condition. And you had a wonderful example from the previous speakers about how devastating it can be on someone's life and the multitude of problems. So when you people say, well, who cares, and we all know there's a whole spectrum of people who don't think there's anything important in this condition, and so what, it's just a reflection of one end of normality. Well, it's all right for perhaps some of these people, and he got 20 gold medals, what do we care? Well, it does care, because you heard such an eloquent presentation. And it also matters because before the advent of genetic testing, we would never have thought that there was such an overlap between all the different forms of EDS. And if there's one take-home message, that's what I want to leave with you, is this overlap. And in particular, I was involved in one case where there could easily have been a miscarriage of justice, where this little girl that you see in the arms of her mother had a small bleed on the brain after a very innocuous injury a week or so beforehand, when she was strapped in a chair and hit her head and got a subdural and some very, very, very light retinal hemorrhages. And she was shown to have the vascular form of EDS from genetic testing, which might not otherwise have been done. And the sad part of it is that, and this is all in the open records, so I'm not giving anything, saying anything inappropriate, is that the testing that was done, if it had been done on the NHS, would not have included the deletions and duplications in the gene for vascular EDS, COL3A1, because it only accounts for 1 or 2% of individuals. And so it's considered so rare, they don't do it. And then when I found it by sending it to a lab in the States, we tried to check it later in the NHS, they couldn't find it. So we then sent it to Leiden, and Leiden did find it. And then when we sent it back to the NHS, they said, oh yes, we found it now. So it's worrying, because of course for the average person who has the milder form of the vascular EDS, it's always going to be the deletion or duplication, the rarer form. So we really need to be on the ball with these patients. We really need to look at the phenotype. And you'll see that she's got these absent earlobes that don't attach, that do attach at the bottom, and these wide eyes. But I'll show you pictures later on of the classical image of EDS, which most people are carrying around, and most non-genetics doctors are carrying around with them. And patients don't look like that, particularly the milder ones. So genetic testing, I think, is so important now. And we need to recognize that in all of these connective tissue disorders, which there's more than 200, plus on top of that, the skeletal dysplasias, that we've really got to be looking much wider and being very critical. And it depends how you put them together in this phenotyping, whether you're a lumper or a splitter. And there's Ehlers and Danlos. And interestingly, I wrote an article once a long time ago about how Danlos was a medical student at the time when it was they described Ehlers-Danlos, which was the type 1, the classical type of EDS. But they, as I say, have these common features, and the Villefranche criteria initially looked at six major types. But there's now been more recent attempts to classify DS together with the genes, and a little bit together with the phenotype. So, of course, it gets really complicated, and it's a challenge to try and remember all of these different presentations. But because there is so much overlap, it's impossible to pigeonhole the patients into one criteria. So you have now got to do panels of gene testing. And the NHS sadly makes you choose either between EDS or between the aortopathy genes, the Marfan-like conditions. And if you want to do both, you have to do twice the amount of testing at twice the amount of expense. And there's an educated process that needs to go on, and there needs to be more description of the overlap. Fortunately, in the private sector, it's easier to do a larger panel. And now, as we know, there's exome sequencing, which is looking at a much broader range. And through that and genome sequencing, we might yet find newer genes yet that we hadn't yet thought about. And, of course, the polygenic inheritance. So I don't need to tell a learned audience about this, but I just wanted to point out some of the overlap, and in particular, the vascular connection between many of these conditions. In the classical EDS, we know there are descriptions and cases of arterial aneurysms and rupture which can occur together with the hypermobility. The vascular EDS, please, I want you to point out the faces on the right. Well, they don't look anything like this beautiful couple. And I would tell you that the mother has the same gene mutation, the deletion, as does the baby. And she went through her pregnancy and had vaginal deliveries and didn't die and didn't rupture her uterus. This is because she's got the mild form. But you can see the big wide eyes, and for me, that looks like vascular EDS. So, you know, again, with the vascular EDS, we know that there's this propensity of arterial and organ rupture, most often on the arterial side, obviously. And as I said to you before, the I don't know how I'm going to use this, but is that it? Yeah, there, if you can just see the red mark there. If you have the null type, which is the deletion or duplication, then you really have the much, much better survival, which you can see, I think there, the 50% survival is up to the age of 80. So really very good survival for that mild type, and that's the one that's going to catch us out. It's very easy when I get the 13-year-old who's sitting watching television and ruptures a bowel. We can all make that diagnosis. It's these types that are more difficult, and they often have small joint hypermobility. And then this one I only put up because it's much rarer, it's a recessive form, but they don't have to have the scoliosis or the kyphosis. I've got two or three examples in our genetic cohorts where again they have this severe hypermobility and hypotonia, but again you'll notice the rupture at the bottom of medium-sized arteries. So there's interesting, there's this vascular sort of phenotype that's running through a lot of these patients. And of course, as has been said, the joint hypermobility and the Ehlers-Danlos hypermobile types are the most common. And I was asked to touch a little bit on osteogenesis imperfecta, which is, of course, much rarer. but as I say, this multisystem aspect is what's now coming to the fore. And you'll all be well aware of the 2017 criteria, which were developed to try to look at the most severe end of the spectrum. And that, in that way, to try and create something of a more significant phenotype. But it has its faults because it doesn't include POTS within it. It doesn't include many of the other aspects that are involved, and only includes the lever joints as part of the measurement of hypermobility. So it's not really adequate. And more importantly, that there's been work showing quite clearly that there's a very poor correlation in children with children who are hypermobile. Only 78% were able to 4% met the criteria, but 78% diagnosed as having symptomatic hypermobility on the basis of the criteria, which are clearly inadequate. And I think it's well recognised by the International Committee that those are going to have to be re-looked at and revised. And I mention all this because it's all about the phenotyping. If we're going to get these genes for HEDS, we need that registry. We need the phenotype. And I think Laurie would agree with me there. Where are you? There you are. And so there is, of course, this group of the TNXB, which is a recessive, but it causes this very severe hypermobility with this really excessive bruising when it's recessive. But it's anecdotal, but I believe there is a subform, a form first, a microform, where you can have one mutation in TNXB and you probably have a degree of hypermobile EDS. as a carrier form. But the recessive form is more easy to diagnose, but it's the carrier form that's difficult. However, the problem with TNXB testing is it's not done routinely because there is a pseudogene that mimics it that's non-functional, and the laboratories have problems testing, knowing which gene they're testing, the real gene or the pseudogene, which has no function. And so it's difficult to get that testing. And plus, there are many, many polymorphisms, normal variations in the spelling of that gene, which make it very difficult to know when you find a change in a gene, whether it's truly causative or not. But TNXB is the one that we're excited to think about and think of. So it follows, doesn't it? Obviously, it's pretty simple if we accept that the genetic anomaly leads to a biochemical problem of collagen chains or connective tissue, and that leads to a biomechanical problem, and you get fragility and tissue laxity, injury and impaired healing. And so that brings me a little bit to the osteogenesis imperfecta, because the most common collagen is collagen 1, col 1, and col 2 in the body. And of course, people thought that that's where they were going to find the gene mutations for hypermobile EDS, but that's proven sadly to not be true at all. And again, there's been many attempts at classification, but fundamentally, it's easy again when you have the classical type, where you have the fracture as a child, the short stature, the blue sclera, and then sometimes the longer-term complications that can occur, together with the basal invagination that's seen in the OI patients. But sometimes it can be very difficult, and we know that 50% of people with OI can present with joint hypermobility, and that may be their primary manifestation. We also know there can be some fractures initially as children, which then they don't manifest much later in life because the bones get a bit stronger and mineralized more. And I mean, careful, that's nothing to do with temporary brittle bones. This is just the natural history of OI type 1. And so diagnosing it sometimes can be easy when there's fractures in the womb or in utero, but type 1 can have quite difficulty sometimes, and you have to really take a careful history. But again, they're in the panels, they're in the genes, but we're all still finding new genes and genes that we didn't necessarily think about. And I mentioned TNXB in the recessive form causes a serious condition, but in the carrier form, it can cause perhaps a milder condition. Well, one gene that's missing from there was a recent gene called LRP5, which you can see in the column, which was recently, we know that if you've got two abnormal copies, it causes thickening of the bones, a kind of osteopetrosis, a sclerosis. But if you have one abnormal copy, a recent paper by Bardai in 2017 identified that a small proportion of patients can have mutations in LRP5, and that gives you a fracture risk without the extra skeletal manifestations. That means without the blue sclera, and not necessarily with the hypermobility. And so that's a real catch-out. So again, we need to be thinking broader and keeping ourselves abreast of the new genes that we're finding. There is no genotype-phenotype correlation that we're able to identify with OI, with the COL1A1 mutations. We now know that there's definitely a level of mosaicism, which means that it's not in a parent, but it's hiding in the gonads, the testes or the ovaries of a parent, particularly usually in the women, and that has a risk of being found to be approximately 15%. So it's possible for there to be no family history but to have two affected children because the woman carries the mutation in the ovaries and therefore there's a chance of it repeating itself. We know that happens for many conditions, and after the 100,000 Genome Project, we think that mosaicism is much, much more common, probably 17% of the population with genetic conditions than we'd previously appreciated. So it's a challenge now, all the time, to keep abreast and do all the testing. I was asked to touch a little bit on Downs, and again, managed to do a little bit of research, but of course it was described first in 1860 by Langdon Down at the time when it was thought that children with Down syndrome were from a different species, published in the London Gazette. But to his credit, at the time, he thought, as he says there, no matter what colour or creed, the children have a remarkable similarity that he thinks we're all a common species. And this was published in the London Gazette under the title The Ethnic Classification of Idiots, because he thought that it reflected the Mongol population and thought that the Mongol population had the same intelligence, which is a very sad reflection, but we've moved on a lot since then. And we're now understanding many of the problems in Down syndrome, and including the dementia risk, that's amyloid deposition that occurs. But the musculoskeletal anomalies are common, and without doubt, I was speaking of Fraser Lawrence, they're definitely underestimated. And that, of course, is compounded by the fact that there's learning difficulty with Down syndrome, where the average IQ is 50. The arthritis that they get is often inflammatory, it's much more erosive, much more aggressive. But there's an incidence of at least probably 10 to 24% of craniovertebral instability. But it's said that they're symptomatic in only about 1%. And again, I accept that may be an underestimate because the patients may not present with their symptoms or have the insight to relate those conditions together. So Foley et al., in where they've recently done a study looking at musculoskeletal anomalies, have suggested that there should be regular screening, and we should certainly be reviewing those patients. But why is it that only 1% are symptomatic? I suspect that's because there must be other genes which are influencing it. Why can a whole copy of chromosome 21 produce such a degree of craniocervical instability? And that's unknown. And similarly with joint hypermobility, we recognize that it occurs in many, many different genetic conditions. And so there must be some modifying effect that any genetic perturbation has on the expression of the connective tissue genes. We know, for instance, that even Fragile X, which is the commonest cause of mental retardation in boys, they often have joint hypermobility. And so when it comes to Chiari malformations, there's a whole host of genetic conditions in which it's known to be associated. And achondroplasia is one of those conditions. And I've seen children with achondroplasia. For those who don't know, it's the commonest form of short stature dwarfism. You might recognize it more as being the diagnosis most often for the type of short stature and dwarfism you see in the circus, those individuals with the normal head size and the slightly shorter limbs, which are shorter at the top half of the arm rather than the bottom half. That's achondroplasia. And those individuals have very extreme joint laxity, and that's an FGR, it's a fibroblast growth factor gene. So again, we don't understand the connections between those genes and joint laxity and hypermobility. And the list is obviously quite long. And the diagnosis, as I said, is therefore always going to be based on family history, particularly with OI, the history of fractures, physical signs, the whole panoply of findings that you have. And I don't do biochemical testing or the skin biopsies anymore because I don't feel that they have enough discerning power. But we may get better in the future, but at the moment it's not something I routinely do. But molecular genetic testing is the big thing. It's using panels. It's using a large array of genes which we pick up, and sometimes you find incidental findings. It does create headaches because you find variants of uncertain significance in the genes. But that's my challenge and my problem, and I think it's better for the patients to have the testing. And these multi-gene panels, if not whole exome sequencing, may have to be the future. And I'm sure it's part of the methodology that's being used in the study. As far as the genes specifically for Chiari malformation are concerned, we are little is known about the genetic components involved. There has been some recent work looking at it, thinking it must be one of the embryological genes involved in somite formation, which is the way in which the embryo divides up the tissues to form discrete blocks, which then differentiate, or one of the vascular conditioning genes. And that's interesting because I showed you the degree of vascular overlap between these conditions, and that may explain why there's this Chiari type of malformation or misalignment. But we just don't really know. But the phenotype is going to be important. Tonsillar herniation is often used in the diagnosis, but that it's not completely correlated with symptomatic disease. And so in order to successfully identify, we're going to have to look again at these patients and work out which ones are similar and which ones are dissimilar. And in that way, we can try and put it all together. So I hope that's given you a quick snapshot of where we are and how we're thinking. Thank you very much.